And welcome to the show, ladies and gentlemen. Everyday People is a show that's brought to you by the good guys at the 6MinuteWebinar.com. And I'm sitting here trying to hold a straight face because I got giggles over here. And we've been having a lot of fun before the show started.
A little bit of trouble.
Oh, yeah. But we're so glad that you tuned in today because we're going to be talking about a topic that really hits home. And that is teachers in our society, teachers that influenced our lives, teachers that touched our lives, and also how the teachers and the parents can work together in harmony for the benefit of the children. That's really amazing. And it's very important too, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, the first outside influence a lot of children have are our role models are their teachers. So the impact that they make on little young minds is just so amazing. Very fragile.
It really is. It's very important too. It's good for the kids to be taught to have the proper attitude towards their teachers starting out. Mm-hmm. Set the foundation. Mm-hmm. That's extremely important in life. Absolutely. And before we get started in here, I got to pay a little bill. We'll be right back right after this brief message.
Hi, I'm Angel Marie Monticelli with Angel Marie Shines, and I had the pleasure, the honor, to go through training for the 6-minute webinar. Oh my gosh, this webinar and how it's structured and how they teach it. Thank you, Speakers Pathway Coalition. Thank you, Don McGrath, and the whole team for the 6-minute webinar, because you made it so simple, easy. And the way you lined it out with the outline, I can reproduce it. And I'm already getting the engagement. I'm getting people that are coming back. They're saying, oh, I love this webinar that's so short, so to the point, and I love your products and what I'm selling, but then what I'm also, the services that I provide, and I can do any of this because I have the framework. So thank you so much to the whole team, because the 6-minute webinar totally rocks. Thank you.
And we're back, ladies and gentlemen, and that 6-minute webinar is the real deal. And most importantly, since Angel went through and since Tamra went through it, we've upgraded it. We got a
You're sharing about all the exciting things that have gone on. It's crazy.
Mm-hmm. It really is. And if you are kind enough to just email us here at the station, either myself or Tamra, the staff will make sure we get it. We will be more than happy to provide you with a free guest ticket for a 3-hour workshop, and you will leave with your very own 6-minute webinar, our gift, free to come, free to leave, no obligation to buy. So just email us at inspiration@e360tv, and we'll be more than happy to make sure you get that link, and thank you so much. But today, teachers make an impact in our lives, don't they?
They do. What's your favorite memory of one of your teachers from childhood?
My fourth grade teacher, Mrs. Blanton. Her first name was Jewel, J-E-W-E-L. And I tell you right now, when they named her Jewel, it's the most perfect name they could have given that beautiful lady. Mm-hmm. Because during that school year, I had pneumonia. And I remember I had to go up to my neighbor's house. She was an RN or an LPN, excuse me, licensed practical nurse. Mm-hmm. And she would give me my shot injection every other day, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Mm-hmm. And I remember, you know, on Friday, I told her one time, I says, you know, I hate Friday. She says, why is that? And I said, I got to get a shot. She says, oh, honey. And she said, but look at the bright side. What are you going to do tomorrow morning? She was able to lift my spirits and get me off the next hour of, you know, no kid looks forward to a shot, you know, especially in the arm. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's what, that was my life, because I had to have penicillin every other day for, I don't know how long it was. It's about 3 or 4 weeks. It was, you know,
wow.
It was a little while. Yeah. I mean, back then,
that's a mark of memory, that's for sure.
Oh yeah. Back in those days, that's when we still had codeine and cough syrup, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm not making that up, young folks. I mean, you
know, I know it's crazy.
Some of the stuff that they gave us, my goodness, it's a wonder if we even made it, you know. But Jewel Blanton was the lady that topped all of my teachers in elementary school. And I never will forget, she always dressed immaculate. But what she always wore was her smile. She was a wonderful lady, and she'll never know in this life how much she meant to me and how much she touched me. And because what I remember from her most is her kindness. My fifth grade now, that's a totally different story. It went from the alpha to the omega. We're talking about a nightmare on that one. And I'm serious, because what
some
happened
of the best
there,
teachers are the ones who gave us the hardest time. It's grow the most.
Yeah.
You know, but,
you know, my look,
gotta love the contrast.
My look, Mrs. Watley, her husband worked on the same crew at the power company that my dad did.
Oh my gosh.
I cannot tell you, rather than being long and boring and keeping this positive, let's just say that there was many times in my life I prayed if the good Lord was coming, I'd hope he'd make it before 5 o'clock. And that's the truth.
Yeah.
I'm not making this up. That's the truth.
You know, I think a lot of the times when we go through school, it was a lot of us don't have really fond memories of school. I mean, mm-hmm. you were forced to go. Mm-hmm. If you rode a bus, you were teased and taunted maybe on that bus ride into school. And then when you got there, it was, you know, trying to get along, to blend in, to be a part of a community. When you go into these classrooms, right, being crammed information, you didn't really understand how you were going to possibly ever use or why mm-hmm. you need to know them, right?
Oh, yeah.
It's like you're in the dark forever.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Of why school is so important. I just have to do this thing.
Yeah, that's exactly so, right.
You know, we bump into that. What's that? Mm-hmm.
And the wonderful thing about school, too, it's a great place for kids to be able to build long-term friendships and to have fond memories of, because that's the world that I remember. I never did have any real problems in school. I got sent to the principal's office a few times, you know, but nothing for, you know, nothing major, anything like that. But
nothing he'll confess on live TV.
No, I'll plead the fifth like a real man, you know. But you know, it's just amazing how you look back on those days, and mm-hmm. you don't realize how they're shaping your life and your future. And the teachers, my goodness, the impact they can have. And Tamra, we were talking right before the show how important it is, especially now with school starting back up, how important it is for the parents and the teachers to have a good harmony and a good home base to get their kids, give them a strong foundation about life and about outlook on life.
Yeah, it can be a real challenge, can it?
Oh, yeah, especially for me when I was a kid. But I know in your area of expertise, you work about relationships, and you work mainly yeah. with couples and things like that. But some of the same principles you teach and you implement and help them in their hour of need, those principles are applicable across the board, aren't they?
Yeah, I actually have a lot of clients that are actually in college, mm-hmm. some that are in high school, some children that are struggling with, you know, having a voice or being able to understand why life is happening the way it is for them mm-hmm. in school. So a lot of the times you may not understand fully the teacher you have, you know, I feel like it's kind of like politics. A lot of times we don't like the president we have, but later mm-hmm. on you see all the gifts they left you,
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
So you have to kind of step back and really see the value of those teachers. You know, what, you know, if this teacher has this personality that you bump up against or you have a hard time with, start looking mm-hmm. for the good things of what they offer so that you're mm-hmm. not always seeing the darkness of what doesn't work in that relationship.
Right.
So it's very difficult. And there is such, there's, again, going back to what you're talking about earlier, there in that contrast of, you know, having a great teacher versus a teacher that really challenges you and maybe in a way you don't enjoy, that experience, you can, the good memories are sometimes not as strong as those intense teachers because they leave such a pivotal direction, a different shift in the way you see life. And you either decide I'm never going to be like that person or I'm going to totally learn from the mistakes I made and do something different with my life.
Oh, so, yeah. It's interesting you say amazing. That like that because we had Dr. Caslow on, fondly known around the world as Dr. K, and she was talking about the work that she does with the one percenters.
Yeah.
And the one percenters, they don't want to hang around with people that's equal to them.
Yeah.
What really attracts them is for someone to challenge them.
Yeah, absolutely.
Or question them, you know, and that's, they don't look at that as being a problem. They look at that as, hey, this is another opportunity to show you how great I am.
Yes. And
you know, having said that, this is also, we're talking about kids. This is also a great opportunity and a great time to teach the child to look at it through the teacher's eyes. Where are they coming from? Understand that they have problems in their lives too. Understand how they feel. I think that is a golden opportunity right there to teach kids the true value of life, set the foundation for them to have great relationships with family, friends, and you know everyone they come in contact with. I really do.
Yeah, I think, you know, a lot of us don't really think about the stages. You know, we go from living at home, just the parents, it's all the world we know, maybe siblings, maybe aunts and uncles and cousins, to all of a sudden a new scope of a stranger, right?
Oh, yeah.
But somebody who's entrusted with our nurturing our minds in a way that develops different kinds of perceptions, ways of thinking or seeing things, and getting a chance to really expand that, create that elasticity so that we can relate better. And so that it is a beautiful process where we, you know, as a parent myself, giving my children to a school and trusting that they, you know, picked people that are creative and expansive and supportive to helping your child grow and foster a beautiful, you know, understanding of life and love the life of learning. Because I truly think the number one job for a teacher is to teach and inspire children to love the life of learning. But sometimes it misses the mark a little bit because you'll have a personality difference, right? Where two don't necessarily equal, you know, a happy, cohesive, celebratory experience. Can very, very, that's like my positive way of saying they don't get along.
They don't like each other.
You know, they hate each other. I mean, I remember one of my kids used to wake up every morning and be like, I have so much anxiety. I'm so stressed out. And I'm like, and he's only four. You know, we're going off to kindergarten. You know, he's just so beside himself. Like, my teacher tells me I can't color good. He's like in the spin. I'm sitting there going, oh my gosh, we're never going to make it.
Is that the same young man that grew up and is now in the Air Force?
Air Force, exactly.
How's his coloring in the Air Force?
He definitely was not a color kid. He's very analytical, not so much creative in the art world. So it is, it's really funny because, you know, I do, I remember him being so stressed out. And I remember even going to teacher meetings and being like, how do I help my kid understand that they're there just to support you? And like, what can I do to make my kid like work better with you? You know? Oh my gosh, it was so crazy. But the experiences are the value, even as a parent working with teachers, like you really have to support the game plan, right? To get your child not only educated, but to help them learn to be in support of that teacher's perspective, because there's different ways of seeing things or seeing things. You know, I said that twice, but you know what I'm saying? The way to grow and learn something from a different scope. So yeah, really celebrating that, you know, that contrast, but they're not always bad. Sometimes they're just amazing teachers. We had some amazing Spanish immersion teachers. We're teaching my kids not just how to speak English but immerse themselves in Spanish language. And it was so cool to watch how the kids just embrace this foreign language. It was really neat.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. They made it playful and fun.
Oh yeah. It reminds me of when, as kids, you know, my mother, especially her, She always taught me and heard her say many times, you're known by the company you keep. And we normally think of that when we're, you know, back when we're young kids or something like that. But really, that's a principle that goes all the way down through the pathway of life. I mean, if you hang out with, you know, nice people and good people, people who want to give back to community, that's how you'll be known. If you hang out with roughnecks, as my dad just called them, and thugs and whatever, I mean, that's how you're going to be known. Birds of a feather flock together. So it's amazing how the things that we're taught as young people, how that really anchors us into becoming, or gives us the roots in becoming the person we're going to grow up to be. Important for us to understand and for us to be able to communicate that with the kids, because a lot of kids, you know, of course, when I grew up, I'm much older than Tamra, you know, about 40 years, but anyway, but you know, the standard answer sometimes we would get when we challenge something, what I have to do that? Because I said so.
I still think that's actually a good answer. I think it's good to educate kids, but sometimes just because I said so.
Yeah, but that, it's most of the time in my life, that was the only answer, you know?
Yeah, exactly. That was the problem.
They probably thought I wasn't smart enough to figure it out and put the pieces together.
That's not true. I think they just, you know, the expectations were so different, right? I remember when I grew up, you know, we were encouraged to ask lots of questions to the point where we probably annoyed the heck out of people. But, you know, nowadays I feel like it's, you're not allowed to ask questions because you're challenging authority. It's just so fascinating, right? The whole cycle of the way things go.
It really is. It really is. And, you know, one of the success principles in life that we all need every step of the way, I mean, sometimes just a pat on the back, or if someone, you know, just sends you a nice, you know, message thinking of you, or hope you're having a good day or whatever. And that one word is enthusiasm. Mm. Challenge kids to get enthused about going to school. And also it works the other way too, getting the teachers enthused about teaching these young kids.
Yeah.
And teachers have a tremendously hard job. I mean, you know, they get kids in there they're undisciplined, and they're, you know, just don't have the right attitude, and they're just there because they have to be there.
Or the simple fact, I mean, I'm sure there's a lot of, you know, some schools do struggle with that. I was talking to a teacher the other day, and it's the pure fact that everything's always changing. There was a school that was emerging to another school, because now that COVID's happened, a lot of things have shifted. Some kids are going to home to school more. And so now these schools are trying to pull resources together. So totally understandable, but you've got two different cultures coming together, right? Mm. So now you're trying to, you know, pull together different communities, because even in those two different schools there are two different kinds of students coming to the school, right?
Right.
So you're now bridging all this, and just every year, I don't know if people know this, but a lot of schools will sign a contract for a certain style of education, say a math theory concept, and it'll be maybe a 4-year purchase. So schools teach that style for 4 years, sometimes longer, sometimes less, depends on what the commitment is, but they not necessarily understand it, or they understand it, but it's not practiced to their finite talent yet. You know, they're still tweaking and making it their own. Mm-hmm. And so it's really fascinating, because teachers are constantly challenged to up their learning themselves, you know, so learning alongside of you sometimes. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, they know the basics, they went to school for that, but the technology is always changing, as we know, right?
Oh yeah, so, 2020 changed a lot. I mean, because like virtual training, the virtual stage, the virtual presentations, it's here to stay. Because let's face it, now that we realize we're not going to die and we got enough toilet paper, okay? And hey, I can just sit here on Zoom or sit here on the internet through a TV show or whatever, and I can be, you know, just like going there. You know, I save a lot of money and all of that. I mean, it's attractive to us, and it's really here to stay. The virtual stage is here to stay for people to be able to be trained. And plus, one person can reach a multitude of people on all topics. So if you're sitting there and you're, you know, you're a teacher and you're wanting to teach someone about whatever the project may be, this is a perfect opportunity for you to be able to do that. Mm-hmm. And to be able to have the end result in mind, because or a teacher in school, their end result in mind is to help their kids reach the certain standards and to be able to go and grow.
Absolutely.
And that should be a standard for all of us in every walk mm-hmm. of life, to help others, you know, reach their goals and the higher levels. It really is. And Tamra, my goodness, I didn't show my manners today. Your website is TamraBlankenship.com. And I mentioned earlier, ladies and gentlemen, she's a subject matter expert in relations. And I'd like for Tamra just to take a few moments here or a couple minutes, whatever, and just share with you what she does, if you would, please.
Thank you. Yeah. I love helping people with relationship communication. So I take on people's conflicts when they're navigating their business, personal or interpersonal conflict, and helping them do something more magical with it. See the possibility and the opportunities to instead of run from conflict, how to address it in a way that you can grow and even deepen your relationship so that you bond with the person you love, or you find your career to be more fulfilling because you're not running from it anymore, which is always a great nugget, right? Getting a chance mm-hmm. to really see the value in your own sense of worth. So, you know, honored and love getting a chance to hear people's stories and help them navigate a little bit differently. We use a lot of different skills, like I use hypnotherapy and talk therapy and a lot of cognitive style addressed to that. They also have been working on, it's more of that, I'm losing my words today. It's using eye retinal transitions to help you shift some of the ways some of your stuck patterns are happening. Mm-hmm. So it's been a lot of fun to expand and grow as well, and continue to, like those teachers, constantly work on expanding my toolbox and supporting people in a way that helps them grow faster. So conflict and depression and anxiety are some of the favorite topics that I love to support people around. Mm. So thank you.
That's, you bet. That's amazing. And like I told you, I mean, she's brilliant in what she does. And I was teasing before the show, you know, about her bringing the brains and beauty, and I'll try to bring something, you know, cough drops or something over here. But Tamra's website is TamraBlankenship.com, and her email address is Tamra@TamraBlankenship.com. So if you'd just like to get in touch with Tamra and, you know, talk with her, or just send her an email and ask her a question, she'll be more than happy to respond
Absolutely.
To you, because she is this lady has got a beautiful heart, and she's a beautiful person inside and out, and she loves to help people. That's her passion in life. And my goodness gracious, it's almost time for us to have another commercial. So we'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen, right after this brief message.
A whole new level of clarity. That's what I received when I implemented the 6-minute webinar. Look, there's no shortage of things that you could be doing to grow your business, to grow your audience, to get your message out there. It's quite dizzying. However, when you get the perfect message in front of the right people, it has an amazing ability to get those folks into action. And so much that is out there distracts us from getting back to that message and finding that right person. With a 6-minute webinar, you can absolutely do that. Hi, my name is Dustin Matthews. I recently implemented the 6-minute webinar on my business and have seen amazing results, and I've gotten a whole new level of clarity. I highly, highly recommend you implement it in your business.
And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. And again, if you'd like to attend the 6-minute webinar for free, the 3-hour workshop, it will give you a 6-minute webinar. You will create it yourself. Please email me or Tamra here at inspiratione360tv.com. Our staff will make sure that we receive your email. We'll make sure you get that link. Free to come, free to leave. And you will have a 6-minute webinar when you're done. That's the beauty of it.
Absolutely.
And Tamra, we were talking about some of the things that teachers have to do, and how enthusiasm. Oh, my goodness. If we could just give a healthy shot of enthusiasm, not only for our kids to have a right outlook about learning, but the teachers to be enthused and make learning fun.
Yeah.
That was one thing that when I got up in the 8th, 9th, and 10th grade, fun was not on the radar at all through me right there. Because I remember, I'll tell a funny story very briefly. One of my buddies, Larry Gamble, came to me during the 10th or 11th grade. I think it's 11th grade. And wanted us to drop world history and take French. And I said, are you crazy? He said, wait a minute. He said, you don't understand. All of the pretty girls are in there. And I said, well, so what? He said, well, if they won't talk to us in English, maybe they'll talk to us in French. That's got to be
pretty
good.
Pretty intelligent.
Long story short, we had to get our parents to sign off on it. Mom would sign off on anything for me, anything from basket weaving to welding. You know, I mean, you know, that's Mom. Dad, he knew me. We were up to something. No. So to make this
you're
long,
running from it, or something, or running to something, right?
That's right. But if it was our idea, it's got to be no good. So to make a long story short, we did not get a chance to take French. We both took world history, and the pretty girls did not speak to us in French or English or even Swahili. But you know, the enthusiasm to have fun in school, make learning fun. That's why hands-on, like the workshop we talked about in the 6-minute webinar, people having a hands-on, being part of creating and being able to be trained in the process. That's what makes it so much fun. That's why it's so successful. It really is.
Yeah.
And I tell you, Tamra, it just really gets me how dry things are and how kids view things as being like, you know, it's like going to the dentist office every day. Some kids have that attitude, you know, changing and letting them have a creative vision that they could be anything they want to be.
Yeah.
How electrifying would that be?
I think a lot of us have been forced into the ideas of doing things because we haven't been, but I remember when I was young, my parents used to say, you can be anything you want to be. Mm-hmm. I almost feel like we don't share that dreaming creativity anymore. Like going back to the enthusiasm you're talking about, I feel like, you know, most kids get that now from the video games. Like, why do they play video games so long? It's because they get to have an alternate reality, right? And they get to play and be something or do something like superhero powers or, you know, whatever that is. And I almost feel like there's a really interesting crossover where we have lost some of our creativity when it comes to academics. You know, we've gotten so analytical and maybe so precision or so precise in the precision of conveying the information, we've lost the play. So I think if you're one of those, I'd love to hear from people who are actually teachers. What do you do to keep enthusiasm, or what I like to say, inspiration in your style of teaching with your students? Like, are you inspired by them, you know, that to be more creative, or has it turned into a process of just cramming that information in, trying to make sure that they miss or that they match the curriculum expectations to make sure that the school stays open? I mean, like, what are the pressures? I think we don't think we are all very educated on the pressures of being a teacher. What's all involved?
I tip my hat to teachers because, my goodness gracious, they're going to have super patience with some of the kids nowadays. But what would really be a great thing is that when a kid challenged the teacher, how the teacher could turn that around and challenge the kid to go to the next level. That would be, that would be incredible, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would be really interesting to hear about those journeys. I think that even just the rapid pace of technology, how are the teachers keeping up? You know, how are you able to keep up with the being inspired and helping that community grow, but also keeping up with it yourself? You know, where's your balance between work and play? You know, because they can't do it while they're in class. You know, they have to take continuing education courses outside of school to keep their jobs. So it's pretty intense.
It really is. You know, teachers and nurses are right in there, and they're the same category because, goodness gracious. they see some of the most challenging things in life, and having a young mind that's closed, oh goodness, that is probably one of the most toughest things to overcome in the education world.
Because,
because a closed mind means, and people can be closed minded all their life. And when they get to be men, in the adult age, we just simply say, oh, he's hard headed. and we say, if you say someone's hard headed, then everybody knows what you mean,
Yeah. It's interesting. That is all about empathy, right? Like, most people stay stuck because they don't feel a compassion or empathy in their lives. So they shell up, wall up against and protect themselves. Rightly so, because if they've not been validated a sense of worthiness or a sense of connection, they can. And so by the time they get to school, maybe their experience with people is that it's unsafe. So can you imagine getting students, like nowadays, what is it, 40 kids in a classroom? It's probably more than that. I don't even know what it is anymore. Just trying to engage all the different learning levels, the attention span, and the ability to convey the information in a way that people can get it, digest it, use it, process it, put it through, and actually regurgitate it back in a test. It's got to be an intense process. And and the classroom sizes, I just can't even, the idea of that, it's just intense.
You know, as you mentioned that brought back something during my military career when I was an instructor. And, when you're teaching, I think the biggest class that I taught as far as in one class is like 35. That's a challenge because you're trying to figure out where everybody is. And I never will forget this one class that I had three or four students that were, let me explain it like this. They were certified mechanics, okay? Mm-hmm. And I'm in there teaching people how to check the oil in a car. I'm in there teaching them how to do this, how to do that, da-da-da-da-da. Well, obviously, if I got four certified mechanics sitting there in my class, they're going to be sitting there going,
really?
Yeah. So exactly. What I did, I said, hey, you guys are way up to speed. We got some people in here that don't even know how to turn on a radio. Would you be my assistant instructors? And got them involved like that. And the energy,
that's just a great idea.
The energy just caught on, and it just came to me. I'd like to say I was smart enough to figure that out, but it just kind of like ding dong in my head. And I go, hey, okay, I can do that. But what if we did that in school, where some kids were, would we see that a little bit when one kid's struggling with math, another kid to help them, but open up that kind of environment inside of a classroom? That would be electrifying.
Yeah, one of the what you're reminding me of is now I also work with a college called Know Your Talents, a corporate division of a college. Mm-hmm. And it's so fascinating. We work on leadership and behavior study. So we help them understand, right now we're working on time management, helping them recognize how they're managing their time and how they're making choices to let themselves get distracted. And like you're saying, a lot of people are at different levels, and to get them engaged in learning. It's one thing to sit there and say in theory, you need to, quantify time, make sure that you're putting your priorities first and going through the process. But it's a whole nother thing to actually, get them in step and actually doing it. So it is, you're right. Yeah. It's that playful opportunity to get them engaged.
Yeah, because the people behind the scenes drawing up the lesson plans, they're sitting inside of a cubicle. And the teachers out there, eyeball to eyeball with real, real people. Mm-hmm. And they've got to pick up on, where each student is, where they're at in their training, and how can they get engaged in a class. That is a challenge. And if you have an understanding mind and you look for people and just ask them questions, but also listen to their answer, understand their answer. And that will give you a clear snapshot on how you can do that. Now, I realize with small kids, we're talking about different things on that level, but you can challenge small kids to help others in their class.
I think that's a great statement. And also, how about as a parent, how can you help your student or your child be a better student for that teacher? And I think it goes back to you know, making sure that there's respect in the communication. Like, you know, I think a lot of the times children interpret an experience based on their point of reference. So they sit there and say, teacher was mean to me. She cut me off when I was trying to talk and tell her, or, you know, they've got all these stories, right? Mm-hmm. And so parents will get heated up. They're like, you're not, you know, they want to represent their child. They feel their child's been wronged. They want to come in there. And so they'll come in guns a-blazing, you know, like trying to like figure out, like, why did you treat my son like that? Or why did you do that? You know, they go in with such force instead of recognizing, I don't have all the information. So going in and supporting the teacher to have those constructive conversations, which teaches your children how to have constructive conversations with you and with their, you know, for the rest of their lives, truthfully, you know, those are another teaching moments or teachable moments that can really not only support the teacher, but also you become an element to your child's growth and development. So it's really important to recognize and creating a structure at home that, you know, teaching your children to stay doing their homework in one place every time, that's the homework zone. And, you know, teaching them that structure of discipline is huge. I think a lot of kids don't have, you know, parents at home, or there's, you know, a parent that's not paying attention to their children's academics because they figure it's the school's job. You know, there's a little of that going on. So it's hard. And there's also the hovering parent who comes in and micromanages that kid all the time. And that kid doesn't have any freedom. So there's all different kinds of stories going on.
One of the things I'd like to see the teachers and the parents do is to focus on teaching their kid to learn from defeat. Learn when things don't go wrong or go their way. You know, when they get up to the plate and their bases are loaded, they're one run behind, bottom of the ninth, and they strike out in front of God and everybody, you know? I'm not speaking from personal experience on that.
I was on first base.
But no, really. But really, you know, teaching them how to overcome disappointments, how to handle that without losing control, how to be, I'm trying to think of the right word there, well-grounded, or to say, it's not the end of the world. It's, you know, it's just a challenge for you. So what if you can't get the ball or get the home run? So what if you're not great in math? That's not going to stop your world from turning. That's not going to stop you from living. You just know that you won't be applying for an accountant. So what? You know, make it light. But look at the other points that they do have, their high points, their gifts, their talents, and embrace those. Because after all, that's what they're naturally created to do. Right. Some people are just naturally created to be musicians. Mm-hmm. They have that talent. I mean, I take me, for example, I play guitar, piano, harmonica, any musical instrument you want to all at the same time. All I got to do is turn the radio on, right?
Ah, I was wondering where that was going to go. That's funny. That's funny.
I do have the gift of a sense of humor. I do have that.
You do.
And sometimes a sense of humor is good to lighten the load or to break the ice. And it's good to have a sense of humor with your kids too. Teach them to laugh at things because laughter is very healthy for you.
I think also teaching
kids to have the best medicines you can give your body.
Yeah. I also think having a curious mind, not assuming because it's on the internet, it must be so. You know, let them get out there and experience the world a little bit.
Pardon me to interrupt him. I'm just going to say, just show them where Abraham Lincoln said, you can't believe everything you read on the internet. I've seen that, you know.
I find it fascinating. You know, I just introduced recently to my daughter paddleboarding. Now, she's the typical teenager who pretty much doesn't want to leave her computer behind in any excursion. Can you imagine lugging a big computer on your paddleboard?
Oh, yeah.
But she is now bitten by the experience of being in Mother Nature. And so every weekend we go off and we paddleboard in the lake, and she's just in bliss. And it's you know, it may be hard to get them inspired to go out and do things and be creative, but the conversations you have with your children in those moments are just so powerful.
I remember one time we were going somewhere. And I was the, you know, smallest one of the kids there, and Dad was driving and Mom was driving. Of course, it was summertime. It was hot. And we had that 455 air conditioning going, you know, four windows down, 55 miles an hour.
No, yeah.
And we're all complaining, you know, because the bigger kids started complaining. So I'm going to complain too. I don't want to go over there. I don't want to, you know, why can't we stay
it's
home?
It's hot.
Yeah. Finally, my poor dad slammed on the brakes. We pull over to the side.
Find you. Everyone's smacking in the back of the chair.
I was throwing the floatboard, you know, because we seatbelts. What seatbelts? We don't need no seatbelts.
I never will forget
what he said. He turned around and he says, "You're going to go there. You're going to enjoy yourself, whether you like it or not. So shut up." But see, dads from that era, they came out of the same mold. And I look at my dad and other dads from that era, and they all had the same type of attitude about certain things. You know, like if a little boy was over there and he had a screwdriver and he's playing around with the wall receptacle or something like that, the mother would say, "George, I'm afraid Billy's going to get shocked. He's going to stick that screwdriver in there. He'll learn."
I'll learn.
Yeah, that was their attitude. He'll learn.
I do you too, man. I've done that.
Yeah.
Not on purpose, on accident.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know, put that little plate on. You know,
yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Kicks your butt.
Yeah, I tell you. And I had that happen to me because I went out and flipped the circuit breaker, except I didn't flip the right one. So I, as you know, this thing's no power to it. I could have very easily taken my voltmeter and checked it, but I reached in, you know.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
It'll wake you up in a hurry. Oh, yeah.
Well, see, I just admitted I was being lazy. I'm like, oh, it's just going to be tightened.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Quick reminder of why you don't walk up to a electrical socket with a screwdriver.
One of the things too that teachers they demonstrate a lot without saying it with their actions, and that is their integrity. And that's something that I wish all kids could pick up and have integrity, because that's extremely important, because that's who you are. That's the foundation of who you are. And you know, Tamra, in your life, I know you've had some great teachers all the way from elementary school all the way up through college and all that. But is there one teacher that stood out for you when you were a child?
Yes, Miss Zipperstein. My academics was very different. Mm-hmm. I had a learning disability, so I dealt with dyslexia and other struggles. So for me, finding safe places to, you know, just speak up was a challenge. And so what I remember Miss Zipperstein doing was really being assertive and challenging me to step up. I had really more from my memory than teachers in classrooms. I had tutors. So I had powerful tutorage throughout my entire academics, and inspired. You know, I was one of those kids who went to school literally from 8 o'clock in the morning until 8 o'clock at night. Just trying to keep up with the average. So it was all about making it fun, because it was a grind. It was a grind for me. So I really value those people who even tutor and support and specifically focus on a specific issue when it comes to being a teacher. Just like a doctor of any other kind, you know, there's special teachers who focus on one topic or another, but their extra patience and their compassion when someone's struggling.
Oh, yeah. Patience is the one thing that came to my mind. You were talking about that, because they've got to have a heart and be patient and be willing to help that child, you know, go the extra mile.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just amazing how, you know, we I got to tell a story about myself. True story. When I was visiting with my daughter and playing with my two grandkids, she says, "Dad, you're a lot more patient now with Colton and Michaela than you ever were with me and James."
It's probably true.
And I said, "Well, you got to understand one thing. Colton and Michaela are not as aggravating as you and your brother were.
And we both got a good laugh out of that.
Always get it better than the child. It's
that's
so
right.
Funny.
That's right. So funny. That's right. And it just amazes me how, you know, when you, as you go and grow and you get older, you understand what's really important in life.
Yes, so true.
And when you when you're teaching a young mind about the future, you're teaching them how to deal with situations and how to handle unpleasant situations, aggravating situations in school, and be respectful to the teacher. Respect for a teacher goes a long, long ways. And I think, you know, if parents would take the initiative on that and say, you may not like the teacher, you may disagree with the teacher, but at least respect the teacher. Respect the investment in time and education and the commitment to be there. And you have the right to, you know, disagree with them, but you don't have the right to make their life miserable or to, you know.
What you're talking about. Yeah. What I hear you talking about there is discernment, recognizing the differences between where somebody else ends and you begin.
Oh, yeah.
And really recognizing that you may not have the same experiences or perspective as that teacher. So you may have true difference of opinion and different approach to an issue. And how do you get along? Because when you go off into the real world and work, you're going to have that. So how great is it that this teacher stepping up to teach your child that skill?
Yeah. Yeah. Cause that's the foundation of the rest of your life, because you're going to run into people that you disagree with. You're going to run into people that you may not necessarily care for, but you know, like them and love them as a human being, respect them from who they are, and then keep your distance so it doesn't destroy your own internal happiness. I mean, that's it. That would solve a lot of our problems today. And that, if we can teach that in the elementary schools, the kids that are still young, we can set that foundation. And once you build that strong foundation, then it's just, that's the roots of life. It really is. And you can just go and go from there. My goodness. You know, we've been talking a lot about, you know, the things that would be great. But let me ask you folks out there, how could you get involved with your school, with your teachers, the PTA, whatever, and how can you let your children know that you're involved and you care? Because a lot of times as parents, we're too busy. We're too caught up in the process of, you know, living rather than get caught up in the process of life.
Yeah,
life's about love and giving. That's when you're the happiest, and that's when I've been the most happiness in my life, when I take me, myself, and I, the big three, as I used to call it, me, myself, and I, out of the equation. Life becomes a lot more simpler, and it becomes more fun. You know, people ask me why I laugh so much, and I have such a weird sense of humor. I said, well, I've earned it because I've done a lot of dumb things in my life. And, you know, which is true, you know, missed that curve. Well, I should have made that one, I think, you know, but learn to laugh at yourself and forgive yourself. A lot of people want to put it in the back of their minds and say, well, you know, I'm going to pretend like I didn't do that or that didn't happen to me. Own it. And when you're open with your kids like that, and they see that, and they see that you're involved with their teacher, and you're going to be there for them and help them understand along the way, keep them, you know, enthused about their education, keep them enthused about, you know, what the teacher is trying to do. Look at it from her point of view or his point of view, understand the teacher, where they're coming from. That's a biggie, because so many times we form our own opinion and we find out, you know, further down the road, we didn't have any facts at all. All we had was myths and things of this nature, and a lot of that misinformation. And
you know, a lot of confusion.
Oh, yeah. It's like that old proverb, that gossip is nothing more than a dainty morsel eaten with great relish. It's a proverb. I didn't think that up. I didn't make that up. I'm telling you the truth.
I know, it's just funny, random.
Oh yeah, because you know how many times you know we form opinions without knowing the facts, and we find out later. So that's why I say it's important for us to teach our kids have an understanding mind. Look from where the teacher's coming from. I mean, they're not there to give you a hard time. They don't go to school every day and say, oh, I can't wait till little Billy gets here. I'm going to give him a hard time, you know. Because a lot of kids have that attitude, the teacher hates me, you know. Have you ever heard that? Have you ever said that about a teacher, the teacher hates me? I have.
Yeah, I think we all feel that way when we feel targeted, when the teacher's asking us to grow a little bit more and we're uncomfortable. The first thing we're going to do is make it about ourselves, right? We're
going
to try to sit there and project discomfort and make it an excuse not to have to show up, not to have to own the responsibilities. I think we all like to run.
Oh, yeah. We all like to justify how we feel and prove that we're right. And, you know, the thing that I remember most about teachers is that they got frustrated a lot. And I think their frustrations were is because me in that class, one of the kids and being one of those kids in the classes there, we didn't have the right attitude. Mm-hmm. And our attitude is, so what? Columbus sold the blue in 1492. So what? What's that going to do for us in life? You know? Is somebody going to hire you? Say, you going to go for a job? Someone said, when did Columbus sell the ocean blue? I don't know. Before I was born, you know?
Yeah.
But it's an honest, that would be an honest answer, but that's not the correct answer. But my point being is that, you know, the attitude we had, and I remember seeing a couple of teachers get totally frustrated. And that's where the parent can come in and bridge that gap by talking to the teacher and then talking to the child and try to get them to understand, look at the bigger picture.
Right.
That's what we have to do all the time in life. Even as adults, we got to look at the bigger picture. Mm-hmm.
I think it's very difficult when you're in it. Sometimes I feel like, you know, I look back into like the Industrial Revolution and starting the birth of the two-day weekend and the whole competing with trying to get the niceties, the house, you know, the perfect house, the perfect car, the perfect job, the perfect this, perfect this, perfect kids, the list goes on. We've forgotten to kind of live life and enjoy it. We're in that rat race of competition. And then before we know it, we have kids of our own and we're trying to raise good fiber, ethical morals and, you know, help kids really shine and be the best version of themselves. Mm-hmm. But we're just, you know, it takes a lot of presence. And when you're tired after working a long day, it can be very challenging to sit there next to Johnny and do all his homework with him, you know, to hold his hand as he tries to figure out math converted in a way you've never seen before. I swear every year they come up with a new format of the way math can be. How many ways can you get to that simple number?
Exactly. I remember when Lisa was going to school, she came home and she was doing this hand thing, counting fingers behind the back. And I'm going like, what is that, sign language or what?
Just like, you know, and the, you know, the complications of, you know, It's just fascinating. The world is moving at such a fast pace. These kids are brilliant, brilliant. And they're not just smart, like computer smart. I'm talking emotionally, their emotional IQ, their EQ is off the charts. These kids are very emotionally aware and they're very wise. They know how to, I hate to say it, they know how to manipulate things to their benefit. You know, they just, not all kids are manipulative, but I mean, we all know how to survive and part of surviving is manipulation, you know, to control an environment outside the discomfort to make something better. So it can be pretty intense. And so being a teacher in that environment that's constantly being fed information from kids listening to TikTok or kids listening to social media, you know, whatever scope that is for them. And then challenging teacher when they're trying to teach to the textbook and there's something contradicting. It's an intense experience for these poor teachers. And, you know, keeping
it
up
really
with that.
Is. And I got to tip my hat to teachers because it takes a special person to be a teacher.
For sure.
Oh, goodness. I mean, they got gifts that I just don't have. I mean, because they got heart. I mean, they got a lot of compassion, a lot of patience. And you got to just tip your hat to them and say, teachers, thank you for what you do and what you have to put up with. And if my previous teachers were here, I'd just simply look them in the eye and say, thank you for putting up with me. That would be an honest answer from the bottom of my heart, you know, an honest plea for them to, you know, just thank them for, you know, putting up with me, because goodness, you know, me and some of my buddies, we were not bad in school, but we were, you know.
Distractors?
Yeah.
I love it. Class clowns are great.
Oh, yeah. But, you know, my luck was, and this happened to me more than once. I'll just use one example. A buddy of mine hit me with a spitball. That's all right. So I waited, the teacher turned her back, and I had a nice one. And I was going to throw it like a home run, you know, like a fastball. And I did. About the time I got released it, threw it as hard as I could, and it smacked him upside the head. She had just turned around, saw the pow. And I heard my name. I thought, well, he started it. I don't care. I just finished it. Yeah. He started. I just finished it. But that was, I got, my parents heard about that. So you can imagine how that, they didn't care who started or who finished it. They only cared about I was the one that did.
You were part of it. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And, but it's amazing because, you know, with you look back on your life and you see some of the mistakes you made, and how can we help our kids understand that we made mistakes, and we want them to understand how the attitude they should have in the classroom, and how they can help another classmate that may be struggling, because the classmate may not have the same kind of a parent that you've got. And that'd be one of the first lessons in how to share your blessings with others.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I tell you. My goodness.
Storytelling is powerful.
Yeah. You know, our time is almost up, Tamra. My goodness gracious.
It's been fast, didn't it?
Yeah, it did. And we're just, you know, this is a topic that you're very well versed in, and it's just right in your alley, you know. It really is. And that's but the time just flew by today. And ladies and gentlemen, if you know a teacher out there, and please share this show with her. It'll be on e360tv.com. Just go down to Positive Vibrations and then go to the right. You'll see Everyday People there. And this will be the latest show that will be there. It'll be up in probably tonight or tomorrow. And on behalf of Tamra and myself, we want to thank you for tuning in. If you are a teacher out there and you're either watching us live or on replay, thank you. Thank you. And I mean, Tamra and I, we both feel the same way about teachers. We admire you for what you do.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And so many times they have a thankless job, don't they?
Oh, yeah.
But if you know a teacher, you be sure and just say thank you for what you do, because they make a tremendous contribution to society, and most of the time, no one knows it.
No.
They do, and when they need to get a thank you once in a while and a pat on the back, and, you know, buy them a gift card or something like that, you know, let them know that they're appreciated.
And not just because it's the end of the year. Give it to them because they do it there. You see them. They need it just as much as we do throughout the year.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And again, on the 6-minute webinar, if you'd like to go to attend, that's going to be on the 24th, Saturday, the 24th of April. It'll start at 9 a.m. Pacific time and Arizona time, 12 noon Eastern time. And it's a 3-hour workshop. You'll leave with a full-blown 6-minute webinar that you created, because it's a hands-on workshop. Just email Tamra or myself here at the station at inspiration@e360tv. I'll pull that up right now. And our staff will make sure that we get it. And most importantly, we will send you the link to a free workshop. It's free to go and free to leave. No obligation to buy. And our time is up. And thank you so very much for being with us. And, oh, we got a comment here from Randy.
Yeah,
coming from a family of teachers, I hear you. Oh, well, thank you, brother. And we hope you have a wonderful weekend. Remember to love yourself first, then you can love others. And Tamra, thank you so much for, thank you for being you. I think I said that earlier today, didn't I?
You did. Thank you for having me here. And of course, love spending our time together on Fridays.
Oh yeah. This is what puts the icing on the cake for me, you know. We thank you so much. Hope you have a blessed weekend. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.